Hello, and welcome back to Higurashi When They Cry, Watanagashi. Last time, we actually didn't get any confirmation that the person on the other end of the phone was Mion or Shion or really anybody. We just kind of got the confirmation that yes, this whoever this person is has been screwing with Kiachi, because apparently Shion's been gone, and still calling him somehow. So either that is actually Shion on the other end continuing to screw with him, and it kind of messed with his plans. Maybe it was actually Mion, or maybe it was something else. I have no idea, but let's continue. Kiachi,
just leave him alone. His friends went missing. It must be really hard for him.
Normally, my dad never shows me any consideration, but this time he did.
Shouldn't Kiachi stay home from school for a while, too? I think it would be safer not to go to the place, to the police, to do something, go until the police do something about this.
Maybe. Compared to what could happen, taking a few days off wouldn't be a bad idea.
Anyway, how is it logical to not close school during such a dangerous situation? What do those teachers think our children are?
Mom and Dad were getting pretty riled up, but at this point I couldn't care less. Besides, that wasn't the only thing I couldn't care less about. The breakfast table, the food in front of me, the time and date, myself, I really had no interest in anything. This feeling, it was like a dead fog in my mind. It felt like getting dizzy after taking strong medication.
Kiachi, how are your studies going? You've gotten further than the other kids, haven't you? If you have, then you can take a few days off, all right?
I didn't feel like answering. Today was Thursday. Only 4 days had passed since the Watanagashi Festival. Such a short time, and yet now things were completely different. Everything had changed. The tranquil village, bright and clear as if it were an Indian summer, had undergone a total reversal. People were made to disappear every night, and we couldn't even relax when walking out in broad daylight. The village had become a world of fear. I had no right to curse this outcome. After all, the one responsible for everything was me. That night, I couldn't resist my honestly tiny, little, and incredibly stupid curiosity and broke the taboo. This isn't somewhere we should be going, is it? Let's not! It's a crime to force your way into a locked building, even if you didn't steal anything. Shion, now that you know there weren't some secret rendezvous, have you had enough, right? I don't want to do something like this. What if Rika-chan's dance ends when we're missing in here? I prattled on as I looked from the lock from Tomotaki's hands and put it back on the door. I'll forget everything I saw here, so come on. Let's go. Takano-san was fretting, but I pushed her away. Tomotaki-san grinned painfully. Shion's shoulders drooped as if to call me an idiot. Even so, I didn't care. I pushed everyone further and further away. Rika-chan's dance was still going on. Then, at last, her dance was brought to a close with roaring applause. I, too, until my hands turned red and I clapped. I clapped and clapped.
Isn't that Rena-chan? She is here because it's your usual meetup time, isn't she?
I looked up at the clock. It was 5 minutes past my time to meet with Rena.
Kiachi, shouldn't you take a few days off from school?
You're right. Thanks for being so considerate. I rose from my seat. I went to the entrance to greet Rena.
Good morning! We're going to school as a group starting today, so you can't be late.
That's right. If we, the furthest ones away, were to be late, the younger kids on the way there would be waiting for us. I think I'm gonna take some time off from school.
Okay.
Rena answered shortly, nodding. I
I think you should do whatever's best for you, Kiyachi-kun. So, you don't need to feel that you're weak or anything. Oh, and, here. It's a notice they're sending around. Could you give it to your mom? I think it has a lot of important announcements in it.
I took the notice. There were a lot more pages than normal. The one on top announced the disappearance of the mayor, Rika-chan, and Satoko, and that they wanted any information about them. It made my heart ache.
The police are looking as best they can, too. They'll find them for sure. Just be patient. Okay?
Rena said, smiling in an attempt to give me courage. Rather than that, though, her smile looked like it was because she herself wanted to believe they were safe. Rena, you're not gonna question me.
No?
Rena, you know, don't you, about that night, what I...
Do you mean when you snuck into the ritual storehouse?
I was speechless for a moment, but then I bit my lip, made up my mind, and nodded a little. So, it's all out in the open. Really, I shouldn't do bad things like that.
Mii-chan was really mad.
So she was upset. I suppose she would have been.
I don't think she was as angry about you sneaking in there, though. As much as about you hiding it from her. Maybe, Ki-chan, maybe you should have told her yourself and apologized.
I should have told her myself and apologized. That troubled me. Just 1 week ago, I did something that I, myself, should have apologized to Mion for. I'd hurt her badly. However, I hadn't realized that at all. Plus, with all the confusion that Shion's appearance had brought, I still hadn't been able to talk to Mion about it. Rena, you're right. I never realize anything until you tell me.
Kiyachi-kun, hypothetically, if you had admitted you had done something wrong right away and apologized to Mii-chan, I wonder if Rika-chan and Satoko would have had to disappear.
I couldn't answer right away. I couldn't admit to that. Wasn't Rena telling me right now, though, that I should have admitted my crime sooner? If I had done that and apologized, would things have gone in such a horrible direction? Rena's eyes were filled with kindness, but they were naive enough to forgive me for keeping my silent, and they stared fixedly on my own. Yeah, you're right. If I had admitted my crime sooner, then Rika-chan and Satoko wouldn't have to had die or disappear. Did she just punch me in the face? Oh, slap. Okay. The palm of Verna's hand slapped me in the cheek. I stood there unmoving, my head still tilted in the direction I'd been hit. It didn't hurt at all.
I don't think anyone has scolded you, Kiyachi-kun. So I'll scold you in their place, okay?
I pressed a hand to my cheek, now warm with embarrassment, and quietly stared down at Rena's feet.
Going somewhere you're not allowed to go was a very bad thing to do. Do you understand that?
Uh-huh.
Answer me with a yes, Kiyachi-kun.
Yes.
Also, what's even worse is that you didn't admit to having done something so bad. You should never do anything bad in the first place, but not admitting to it or apologizing for it is much, much worse.
Yes. I was wrong. For a few moments, Rena stared at me silently and intently, as if gauging my remorse. Then, finally, the tension in her face softened and she smiled.
Okay, then. It's about time. I should be going.
All right.
Be sure to give the notice to your mom, okay? Also, warn her not to go out to pass it on after it gets dark.
I bent down and picked up the notice, which I had dropped when she slapped me. The pages had come out of the class they were in and now made a mess on the floor. I gathered them up one by one. My hand stopped at a single, more light-hearted page with a peaceful sentences dancing on it. We still have plenty of homemade soy sauce in stock. Feel free to come to the Sonozaki house if you want some. What is this? I picked up the page and scanned the rest of it. They were stockpiling high-quality soy sauce they got from faraway relatives in the Akita Prefecture. They had gotten a big shipment recently. They couldn't use it all, so they wanted anyone who wanted some to feel free to come over, is what it said. As a PS, it said that it arrived in barrels and to please bring a 2-liter bottle or so container for it. That's how it tied together. If you needed some soy sauce, then you would go to the Sonozaki house. Rena, did you know this all along?
Yeah, I knew.
Rena had already been suspicious of Mion as soon as she noticed that big bottle of soy sauce was missing. Rika-chan had taken the bottle and gone to Mion's house, and there, she was erased. Rika-chan wasn't coming back, so Satsuko called Mion's house, since she knew where she had gone, and then Satsuko got called there as well. That meeting on the day the mayor disappeared, didn't Owashi-san say that the three families participated in it? The three families would include the Sonozaki family. Didn't he also say that the current leader was really old, so her heir Mion frequently stood in for her at public appearances? While the mayor was returning from the shrine, Mion called out to and stopped him. She talked to him and invited him over to their house, and then she made him disappear. It was probably even simpler to make Shion disappear. Shion was part of the Sonozaki family. They probably knew exactly what she was doing at all times. I'm sure they even knew her part-time job schedule, too. Thinking back, wasn't that Angel Mort store managed by the Sonozaki family? Setting up an ambush for her there wouldn't have been any trouble at all. I'm going to Mion. I'll go apologize. I'm going to have her put an end to everything. Mion probably won't forgive me easily, but I'll go and ask her not to sacrifice anyone else. With that decided, there was no need for me to be lazing around here. I put on my shoes and slipped past Rena to exit the house when she stopped me.
I'm going too!
Rena, shouldn't you go to school?
This is way more important than school!
Rena, you shouldn't come. If you get wrapped up in this too, then I think I might actually go crazy. Rena didn't move her arm, which was blocking my way.
If Kiyachi couldn't disappear as well, then I think I might actually go crazy too, so I won't let you go alone.
Rena argued boldly as tears welled up in her eyes. I saw them and I knew the strength of her resolve. All right, let's go. Thank you, Rena. Rena nodded silently but firmly and finally let down the arm blocking me. Let's go to Mion's house. I'll apologize for the crimes I've committed. Then we'll put an end to these twisted days. After that, I'll pray that once more we can return to those fun and lively days. With Rena following me, I left the house. In front of the house, there was a car waiting. It was Owashi-san.
Oi, good morning, Mahibara-san. To you too, Ryugu-san. Together so early in the morning, you make me jealous.
What a truly praiseworthy man he was if he had been lying in wait so early in the morning just to pressure me into talking. On this morning, though, maybe this was actually a good opportunity.
You're from the police.
Oh, have I not introduced myself to you, Yurigugu-san? Please, excuse my rudeness. My name is Awashi from the Okinomiya Police Department. Pleased to meet you.
Are we telling Awashi-san?
Are we telling Awashi-san?
Yeah, I think my palm is enough punishment for your crime, Kiyachi-kun, but We should leave Mi-chan to these people.
Pain and sadness. I look down at those emotions built up in my heart. We have something to tell you, Owashi-san.
Well now, what about? Should we stand here and talk, or go inside the car?
In the car, please. I only continued to look down weakly. All I could do was be thankful for how dependable Rena was. At Rena's urging, I revealed everything to Washi-san. The latter, while making sure to throw in the murmurs that he was paying attention every now and then, took notes. We continued that way for a while.
How do you feel? Don't you feel a lot better now that you told me?
Washi-san asked this while scratching his head with his ballpoint pen. Of course I didn't feel better. The price that had been paid up until now for me not owning up to my crimes had been so immense, but as long as that punishment wasn't returned, the load on my chest could never be removed. His radio started to emit static.
This is Kumintani. Owashi-san, over.
Yes, hello. This is Owashi.
We got news a few minutes ago that she's been absent from school. No movement at the Sonozaki house. Our target is still on the premises.
Yes, good. Keep a close watch out.
Roger that. Cars 3 and 7 just arrived for support, and we will return to base. Also, I think the division chief is looking for you, Owashi-san. He keeps annoying me too, even though I keep telling him I have been trying to get in touch with you. What should I do?
If you're all pressed for an answer, tell him you're actually under orders not to wake me from my morning nap.
Got it.
Bzz, the radio grew silent.
Sorry about that. It was about work.
He just said there was no movement at the Sonozaki house, didn't he?
Oh my. Did it sound like that to you? This won't do. Please, keep that a secret, alright? I don't have permission from my division chief to be making private inquiries like this.
Owashi-san had suspected Mion for a long time.
Nor for questioning the witnesses, or for searching houses. We don't have permission for anything, really. The Sonozaki's house defenses said to protect the family members are also in full working condition. Without a warrant, we can't do anything about anything, unless the crime happens right in front of us.
Owashi-san, could you be...
Rena's tone of voice alone was enough to make her spite clear as she stared at Owashi-san.
You can't set foot in the Sonozaki house. Were you trying to get Kiyachi-kun to go in there instead?
Rena, that's... What do you mean?
This person, just as I thought, he plays really dirty.
Stop! You're hurting my reputation. That said, I'm all ears to your explanation, okay?
Owashi-san lit a cigarette and responded to Rena wearing an expression implying he was calm and willing to let her comment slide.
You can't get a warrant, but you've always had your eyes on the Mi-chan because you thought she was suspicious.
Yes.
You plotted to incite Kiyachi-kun and have him go to the Sonozaki house. Then, if something were to happen to him, you would have used that as an excuse to go in. Isn't that right?
I only understood about half of what Rena was saying. I knew, however, that Owashi-san had been trying to use me.
Even if Kiyachi-kun got hurt as a result, have you no shame? This is not how the police do things.
My, my, it seems we have an incredible detective on our hands. Oh my, oh my. Would you be interested in taking our exam? I'd be gladly to write up a recommendation letter to get you into the full detective division.
You're despicable.
Rena spoke quietly, her words dripping with hostility.
You're despicable.
Well, I've been insulted in all kinds of ways in my life, but one or two words from a young girl is always the roughest for me.
Even so, I suppose I should thank you for not arresting Mi-chan yet.
Don't mention it.
Uwashi-san seemed to be enjoying this exchange with Rena. The things this man thought were like a swamp I could barely see past the surface. It reminded me again of how much I disliked him.
Now then, as two esteemed friends of me and Sonozoki-san, what are you planning on doing now? Will you wait kindly for me to go over the evidence and request a warrant?
No, we won't wait for that. We'll go and we'll make Mi-chan surrender herself.
That's right. If she turned herself in rather than being arrested, she might get a lighter sentence. At this point, perhaps that was the only pity I could find in me to afford her.
I see. I wonder if that will go that well. If you were careless, you too may face danger, you know.
Uwashi-san was measuring our resolve, so in a strong voice I declared, "We're fully prepared." Uwashi-san gave us an unpleasant, yet seemingly satisfied grin. It was then that I realized that this man was trying to use us for his own convenience.
If anything should happen to us, use that as an excuse. Though, my greatest hope is that you will get surround the place so that the criminal can't get away.
Ryugi-san, you're good at negotiating too. I'm throwing in the towel. I surrender.
What are you talking about?
If the policemen surround Mi-chan's house, then that will be insurance for us in the worst-case scenario. For the worst case.
Plus, it would be another way of pressuring Mion to give herself up, wouldn't it?
Awashi-Takuma-chan.
Oh, wait.
Awashi-Takuma-chan. Awashi-Takuma-chan.
This is Kumatari. Go ahead.
Our two friends here are going to play at the Sonozoki house. Make arrangements so that we can reinforce them if needed.
Roger.
Their altogether too short conversation implied that our questioning was already a part of their plans.
Then, let's get going. Want to buy some tea biscuits on the way there?
Neither Rena nor I went along with Iwashi-san's stupid joke. Iwashi stopped the car at the place where we always waited for Mion. Come to think of it, I've never been to Mion's house before. I've only heard that it's right down this road.
This is as far as I can take you. According to our information, there are quite a few security cameras set up on the premises. Still, don't worry. I've got a bunch of youngsters ready and waiting to slip past them and go in. We'll be monitoring the inside with a one-way mic, so if you two give a loud scream, we'll know right away.
We'll persuade her for sure, so please don't be ready. Please be ready for her to turn herself in.
In both our eyes was determination. It was the only method available to us for lightening the sins of our good friend.
Be plenty careful, you hear? You probably don't believe it right now, but I don't want you two being sacrificed if at all possible.
You're right about that. With that rude response, we left the car. The clinging humidity and voices of the cicadas greeted us. I had never had expected this would be happening today.
Let's go, Kiyachi-kun!
Rena took the lead and began to walk down the road I've never been. Rena, you've been to Mion's house before, right?
Yeah, a few times. It's a really big house. You could fit a mountain into their backyard, too. You can pick up mushrooms and stuff, and there are fences everywhere.
Big enough to fit a mountain? That was amazing. One of the three families controlling Hamanazawa and the head family of the Sonozaki clan. Perhaps there was something to be said about its magnitude. The path continued onward, level and uneventful. There were metal fences along its edges, and beyond them were woods with trees growing thickly. The fences were high. the tops of them bent inward, sticking out like sharp spears. Plus, there was a dangerous-looking barbed wire wrapping them. No one could look at them and not feel intimidated. In addition, there were signboards hung up here and there along the fence. Private property of the Sonozaki family, entrance forbidden. Beware of venomous snakes. Active security cameras. Intruders will be charged an entry fee of 1,000,000 yen. This forest, or should I say mountain, is this all their yard?
It's more like their domain. As you can see, it's private property, but nobody maintains it. The forest isn't really the kind that you would go hiking in.
She could say that again. I really did feel like a neglected, savage woodland. It was a dark and damp and certainly not a forest that made you want to go for a nice walk. Maybe that's just what happens when a landowner has too much land. Like Iwashi-san said, there were security cameras hung up all over the place, though they had been weathered by the wind and rain, casting doubts as to whether they were even functional. I wonder if Miona's watching us as we come to her.
I don't think she is. The only people living in Mi-chan's house are generally her and her grandma, after all. There's nobody to watch the cameras.
What a useless security system.
Well, Mi-chan's father seems to like a pretty tough person to get along with. So, whenever everyone in the family is getting together, the cameras are apparently working properly.
That's right. Mion's father, he was a big-shot Yakuza, wasn't he? Rena smoothly danced around the answer as she explained. At last, a huge gate as big as I had imagined appeared. Was she living by herself with her grandmother in a house with such a grand entryway? I wonder if she's here. Beep. The old buzzer made a dull sound. Was it cut off in the middle and not getting to the house? Was it cut off in the middle and not getting to the house? We waited long enough without response for me to start thinking like that. However, we finally heard footsteps walking through the gravel on the other side of the gate. I nervously balled my hands, my palms now sweating into fists. There was a clang of the bolt being released and the gate opened silently. The person peeking out of the gap was none other than Mion.
Well, this is unusual. Aren't you two going to school?
Mion didn't seem all that surprised at visitors arriving in the morning, which wasn't at a normal time. In fact, she almost seemed relaxed, as if she knew we were coming beforehand.
We stayed home today.
Ki-chan is one thing, but you two, Rena? You two are such troublemakers.
Mion smiled lightly in the way that Mion we knew always did.
Well, let's not just stand here. Come on in.
She gestured for us to follow her. I hesitated for a moment, looking at Rena.
Let's go!
Rena smiled cheerfully as if she were passing through the gate of a good friend's house, and then did just that. I rally myself and then go through the gate too. On the other side, it hadn't been maintained very well, but it was clear that the lot was magnificently wide. It wasn't quite what you'd think when you hear mansion, but it was very clearly a vast place.
Was this the first time you've been here, Ki-chan?
Yeah. This house is enormous.
Steep thatch roofs aren't in fashion anymore. This place could be a tourist attraction. I want to rebuild it using a totally average and boring reinforced concrete soon.
Mion dryly smiled as she said that, then closed the gate and relocked it with a heavy bolt.
Don't worry about it. Things haven't been dangerous lately. Don't worry about it. Things have been dangerous lately. Gotta do at least this much during the daytime.
Yeah, you're right. Maybe it was my imagination, but I thought I saw the hint of a shadow in her smile.
Well then, good sir and madam, I shall show you inside. Please, come this way.
Mion bowed to us like a worker at a high-class hotel, then pivoted on her heel and began to walk. Rena gripped my stiffening arm lightly.
Kiachi-kun, you're too tense. We came to see Mi-chan, remember? You don't need to be that nervous.
That's right. When I get nervous, I tend to let everything show on my face. I'll stop tensing up. Even if something were to happen, there were two of us. Owashi-san's subordinates were waiting outside the gate for us, too. There was nothing to worry about. After thinking about it that much, I realized my nervousness was already gone, and laughed at myself. What's this? Mion, what's with this stone atop the newspapers? It's in the way. There was a pile of newspapers on the floor of the entrance, and there was a large rock on top of them. I didn't understand why something like that was here. Rena noticed me looking at it questioningly and giggled. Rena, do you know? What is this? Some kind of good luck charm?
If you don't really know, then feel free to move it out of the way and put your shoes there.
Kiachi-kun, that's a nest of swallows right above that stone.
Huh? Oh, you're right.
This house is for people, but swallows still come in without permission and make nests. It must be like a tradition for them. Whenever spring comes, they always make a nest here. It's kind of annoying, though.
In other words, it's a sign to not take off your shoes here because the swallow poop could end up in them.
I couldn't help but laugh at the silly contrivance. My laughter naturally spread to the other two.
A really long time ago, the Sonozaki family apparently cultivated silkworms. Our ancestors would get all worked up over exterminating the swallows. When you think about it that way, maybe this is our just desserts. Anyway, come on in.
The inside of the house wasn't very bright at all. It was dimly lit, in fact, but mysteriously I could still feel an elegance to the place. Mion seemed to want a more modern building, but traditional houses like this aren't bad either.
You're kidding, right? There's a terrible draft and the winters are freezing. Don't go making my house into a property of cultural significance and getting in the way of my renovations, got it? What I want most is a house like yours, Ki-chan. I'm pretty jealous of it. It seems like it would be warm in the winter. Oh, but the snowfall seems like it'd be a problem.
Snowfall's a problem? Does Hamanazawa get that much snow? Our latitude is south of Kanto, isn't it? Isn't this region warm?
You don't know, Kiyachi-kun? Hamanazawa is an area that gets heavy snowfall. When we get a lot, everyone gets buried. Sometimes you can't even get out of your house.
Sometimes your car gets totally buried too, and you can't find where it is.
I wasn't aware of that. Hamanazawa, was this place that bad in winter? Come to think of it, my dad, he said something like this place got plenty of snow, so we could have fun building igloos. Still, your front door getting buried, not being able to find your car? That's way too much snow.
You remember from geography class, right? The western side of Japan gets cold winds from Asia. We're different from those softies protected by the mountains, nice and warm in the Pacific Ocean.
I'm totally okay with being a softie and nice and warm. I hate the cold.
We'll have to have a training camp to get Ki-chan used to the cold this winter, then.
No way. There's no way that's happening. I hate the cold, and I hate training camps, too, and I hate them even more put together. Mion laughed more uproariously than she ever had, then told us she'd bring out some tea and left her seat for the moment.
Still, there's a lot of fun things to do in the winter. I bet our club will be a blast, then.
Our club continuing activities through the winter sounds totally horrible. Like swimming in the cold or marching in the snow. When did we turn into Mount Redhorn?
Yeah, there are are definitely a lot of punishment games for the winter season. Tough punishment games. One time, she made us have a Rio carnival in the schoolyard while the snow was falling.
I see the terror of our club cared not for the season. The victor would be decided by those who could best adapt to the winter-only events.
We do snowball fights and shaved ice-eating contests and treasure hunts in the snow.
Wait, why is everything outside? Why can't we play tabletop games in nice, warm room when it's snowing?
Whoa, Kiachi-kun! If you're saying things like that, then you're gonna lose a lot this winter! We'll have a lot of punishment games and Rena won't lose, ow!
Don't give me that, ow! I'll settle things with a cross chop to the head. You're sure having fun. Our walls aren't very thick, so be careful not to go flying through any, okay? The paper sliding door opened and Mion returned with a pot and a complete tea set.
Do you want sesame seeds on your rice? Sorry, we don't have much in the way of bean paste or other good stuff.
It's okay. We didn't really come here to drink tea anyway. And with those words, the smile disappeared from Rena's face. Ah, she did it. Wait, was that Rena talking?
It's okay. We didn't really come here to drink tea anyway.
That one careless statement reminded us of what we had nearly been able to forget. I had wanted to enjoy this peaceful time for a little longer, but we put an end to that with those honestly careless words. When she noticed the smile disappear from Rena's expression, Mion too changed hers. It was as if her cheerful air, that was like a warm spring day up until a moment ago, had slipped through the cracks into the paper door, and altogether disappeared. There was no point in regarding it now. We did not come here today to chat and enjoy ourselves. Mion silently poured the tea. During that time, both Rena and I sat kneeling without uttering a word.
Here you are. Drink up.
We couldn't even mutter a word of acknowledgement at those natural words of courtesy.
There's no poison in it or anything. Do you distrust me that much? That's upsetting.
Mion gave a bitter smile at that and let her shoulders droop. We all remained silent. We remained silent, hoping that someone else would speak up first. That was, however, the one thing we didn't want to do, and so we sat for a long time. At last, Mion smiled scornfully and opened her mouth to speak.
Hey now, Kichan, Rena, you're the guests. Didn't you come here for something? If you don't speak up first, this old man won't know what to do.
Rena and I exchanged glances, and we both resigned ourselves. Rena opened her mouth to speak first, so I stopped her.
Kiachi-kun!
It's okay. I needed to come here. Let me talk first.
Okay. I understand.
What would Kichan have to tell me? Please, give me your daughter's hand in marriage, maybe. Can't do that. My little Rena and Kichan aren't meant for each other. Go wash your face with miso soup and try again later.
Afterwards, I thought her mean remarks were Mion's own way of showing consideration. Mion had said those mean things in a totally normal voice and had drained the tension from my shoulders. Mion, first, I have something to apologize for.
You do? What for?
Mion pretended that she didn't know what I was talking about, but I clearly had gotten my point across. Well, on the night of Watanagashi, the ritual storehouse behind the shrine, I went in there. I could see Mion's expression immediately become harder. I knew it was somewhere I wasn't supposed to go, but it was just supposed to be a little bit of exploration. We didn't mean anything by it. Even so, I still shouldn't have done it. So I apologize. I'm sorry. To display my deepest sincerity, I pressed my forehead to the table. I meant to do it as a way of posturing myself. I figured it wouldn't feel sincere enough if I raised my head right away, so I left it there on the table for a while. Mion didn't say anything. With my face down, I couldn't tell what sort of expression Mion had. Only the voices of the cicadas filled the room. Mixed with them, I could hear the sound of the clock ticking. That was all. When I started to struggle to breathe from having my head down for so long, Mion told me to stop.
You got me there. I didn't expect you to pitch it to me straight. You got me on the ropes.
I looked up to see Mion's face was calm, but she was smiling faintly.
If you understand that even though it was only a casual exploration for you, Ki-chan, that there are a lot of people who think it's no laughing matter, then it's okay. There's an old saying, when in Rome, do as the Romans do.
It's been days since then. It may be too late, but I apologize. What I did was wrong. Please forgive me. I could feel pitiful tears welling up within me. If I had done this sooner, maybe nothing terrible would have happened.
It's okay. If you know what you did was bad, then that's enough, right?
Mion spoke like it was someone else's problem, and I was happy about it. And I wasn't happy about it.
Mi-chan! Kiachi-kun is apologizing seriously. I think maybe you should respond seriously as well. As well.
I'm being serious, though. Do I not look serious to you, Rena?
You don't.
Rena was giving her tit for tat, and so the room's atmosphere quickly began to grow sharper. She was right. Even though I came here to speak from the heart like this, it felt like she hasn't been taking this seriously. Obviously, Rena isn't fond of that.
Kiachi-kun, you can get up now. Let's tell her everything. That looks like what Mi-chan wants to.
I had known it would turn out like this from the beginning. Hadn't I come here prepared for that? I mustered my willpower and bit my lip. Mion, you called Rika-chan and Satoko the day before last, right?
I don't remember doing so. If you have a reason to think so, could you let me hear it?
It was evening, before dinner time. Rika-chan should have come here, bringing a big bottle of soy sauce to have you share some with her. Mion was trying to keep from showing any reaction, but I didn't miss her eyelid twitching just a little bit.
Why do you think that?
It's not hard to understand. Mi-chan, you saw it too, didn't you? Rika-chan's room?
Mion put a finger to her forehead and acted like she was thinking.
There was chilled tofu, but no soy sauce. Plus, the big bottle of soy sauce that should have been under the sink was nowhere to be found.
Oh, wait, that was Rena talking.
There was chilled tofu, but no soy sauce. Plus, the big bottle of soy sauce that should have been there under the sink was nowhere to be found.
What? That's why she would have come here.
Mion, drop the act. You wrote it in yourself in the notice, didn't you? That you'd share your soy sauce? Mion scratched her head. I heard her ever so faintly click her tongue. It was as though we found out she'd purposefully given too little change to a servant. That's all I could feel from her. Wait. Oh. I get what that sentence meant. Then, Mi-chan, Rika-chan, you hit her. Rena, oh.
Then, Mi-chan, you, Rena-chan, you hit her.
Rena-chan hesitated for a moment. I could tell that she didn't want to use the word erased, but that she was struggling to find another word.
That was really supposed to be the end, wasn't it? For you, anyway?
What are you talking about?
You didn't foresee that Rika-chan would tell Sadako-chan that she was going to your house, did you, Mi-chan? Then Sadako-chan called. Maybe Rika-chan might be imposing on you. Yeah, probably just like that.
You sound just like her.
Mi-chan, you were in a bit of a bind then, because someone knew that Rika-chan had come here. So you decided to lure Sadako-chan here too.
Lure her out? Like, how, I wonder?
Mion prodded Rena on as if trying to get the good part of an interesting story. I, however, knew I had been watching Mion change the whole time. She was restlessly twirling her fingers as if she had clearly lost her calm. Of course, it was really a slight thing, and only I, who would have been watching her this whole time, would have known. Mion was panicking. What Rena was saying must have been a bullseye.
It probably went like this. Satoko, I actually made too much dinner today, so why not come over and eat? Rika-chan came earlier and already ate some. Something like that.
Scratch. Mion's nails dug into her knee.
There's no recordings of the phone conversations or anything, so how do you know that much?
I know it because the dinner that Sadako-chan made for the two of them was plastic-wrapped in the refrigerator and hadn't been touched.
For a few moments, Mion's face was frozen in utter amusement. She looked like she couldn't believe that this person in front of her was Rena.
With just that to go on, how did you even guess what we said over the phone?
It's a long explanation, so I'll get to the point. The contents of the refrigerator provided a vivid account of what you said over the phone when you lured her out.
Mion's jaw remained on the floor. That was the only way I could describe her face.
That's... I had no idea I had such an incredible detective right next to me the whole time. I can't believe you'd figure out everything, down to the phone conversation, just from what was inside the fridge. You got me there. You've got me. You've got me.
As if a dam had burst, Mion convulsed into laughter. Her laughter, though, definitely didn't make us want to laugh as well. Mion grew tired of her dumb laughter, heaved a big sigh, and scratched her head. It almost seemed like Mion had lost a detective punishment game for the club or something, and her punishment had been decided. Oh, how fun that would have been if it were true.
An incredible detective! Mi-chan, you're the one who guessed what Iwashi-san told us. He called me an incredible detective, too.
As soon as she heard Iwashi-san's name, Mion's eyes began to display panic more clearly and so that anyone would be able to tell.
Mion,
the police have suspected you for a long time now. Iwashi-san's officers have had the house under observation so that they could break in at any time. Mion attempted to feign calm, but it looked as though she had a hard time with that. Part of her couldn't believe that the police had had her surrounded, and she closely examined Rena's facial expression. However, she couldn't detect a hint of falsehood. Finally, Mion seemed to accept the fact that the police were encircling the house.
Was the mayor Mi-chan too?
Were Tomotaki-san and Takano-san you as well? Mion didn't answer our rapid-fire questions. I could clearly see impatience in her eyes, which were still feigning calm. At last, Mion, who had been sitting there lazily, readjusted her cushion and sat herself upright. At that moment, the atmosphere in the room changed completely. Mion's expression also changed. The impatient and wonderment The impatience and wonderment in her expression disappeared, and she became so solemn you would think she was about to conduct a tea ceremony. I could sense it. It was now, in this moment. Mion had ceased to be Mion, and had changed into Mion Sonozaki, the current heir of the Sonozaki house. That solemn atmosphere about her was clearly abnormal, and was entirely different from that of the Mion that I knew. Now I could believe it, that she was the young leader who commanded the entire Sonozaki clan. Mion quietly placed both her hands on the tatami mat, and gave a beautifully elegant bow as if this really were a tea ceremony, and named herself.
We meet for the first time. I am the current heir of the Sonozaki house. My name is Mion.
Mion's movements were so elegant they could cut, and we couldn't even answer her. All Renna and I could do was watch, baffled at her actions, which we never imagined the normal Mihur doing.
I would like to welcome you to the Sonozaki main house today. I will greet you all in place of our leader, Oryu. It seems as though you have various things you would like to ask. If I can be of any assistance, then I would like to answer without concealing anything.
What? What did Mion just say? Mion said she would answer anything we asked. There was a strong light of resolve in her eyes. It's really all right if we ask anything, then?
I shall tell you everything I know. That's why you've come here, after all.
Renna and I exchanged glances. There was a mountain of things we wanted to ask Mion. However, we hesitated for a moment on what we should ask first. The first question Renna gave was extremely abstract, but it was a question everybody wanted to know right now.
Why? Why would you do this?
That was what I wanted to ask as well. Why would you do this? That didn't only go for Rika-chan and Satoko. It went for the mayor, Takano-san, and Tomotaki-san as well. No, even further back, for all the incidents that had been occurring every year. For a little while, Mion couldn't respond. Right when we realized that question was too vague and tried to put it into more concrete terms, she finally opened her mouth to speak.
To answer that question, it will take some time. If that is acceptable, however, then I would by all means like you to hear it.
She spoke clearly. She spoke with a clarity that a grandmother might use when telling a story from a long time ago.
Do you know that Hamanazawa Village used to be called Onigafuchi Village?
Renna nodded lightly, then shot me a glance asking me if I did. I returned her nod. Hamanazawa was once called Onigafuchi Village, yes. I heard about all that the night from Takano-san in the ritual storehouse. They firmly believed that demon blood ran through their veins and cut off all contact with the outside world. They were worshipped by those in villages at the foot of the mountain and treated like transcendents those capable of magic.
That's right. Our ancestors in Onigafuchi Village were proud transcendents descended from the demons. Those in the village at the foot of the mountains worshipped and honored them. Nevertheless, that all decayed with the end of the Tokugawa era. The black ships arrived, the era of the samurai ended, the era of national isolation ended, and the tradition of worshipping Onigafuchi Village quickly disappeared. Those things that linger from the past were all to be detested. That was the kind of era it became. The Meiji era began, and the name of Onigafuchi Village, with its long history, was forcibly changed to Hamanazawa Village. I have heard that the Meiji government strongly wished to erase the old customs. The abolition of feudal domains and the establishment of prefectures. An era had begun, seeing Japan sprinting up the stairs that were beyond their means to try and reach the same level as the rest of the world. All the things in Western style were to be extolled, and while all the old traditional things were to be scorned. That was the sort of era it was. Our ancestors in Onigafuchi Village were proud transcendents descended from the demons. Onigafuchi Village disappeared in a flash. At last, Japan, provoked by the great European powers colonizing countries in Asia one by one, began a policy to increase wealth and military power so that it could stand as a global power in its own right. corruption began and they won war after war. The first Sino-Japanese War and the Russo-Japanese War, and then the Pacific War broke out. They recklessly climbed the staircase. Of an era of hardship. Thus began the harsh days where only one would suffer unreasonable discrimination just because people knew one was from Onigafuchi. The children in the village at the foot of the mountain were taught not to go near Hamanazawa because filthy germs were rampant there. Children who had come into contact with children in Hamanazawa would cry and wail as their parents purified the spot they were touched by rubbing salt on it. One of the adults said to the children that if you got lost in Hamanazawa, you would be kidnapped by demons, cut up into pieces, and devoured. Never, ever go near the terrifying village of man-eating demons. That was what he taught them. Another said that during the famine long ago, the people of Hamanazawa gathered up all the corpses they had discarded into the dry riverbeds, then cooked and ate them in order to survive, groundless stories, but said in such seriousness. Baseless slander added to the baseless slander, making Onigafuchi Village historically accurate, thrilling history all the more believable. Perhaps the chain of undue discrimination was a manifestation of people's anxiety towards the uncertain times. Of course, the story didn't end only with the perspective of the children. If anyone found out you were from Onigafuchi, you would be turned down from any job you applied for. People would even go back on engagements and marriage proposals. As for marriages where one partner had lied about it, as soon as the truth got out, they were made to divorce. It even caused trials. They would appeal that where one came from wasn't an important enough reason to divorce. They would, however, lose their case. Lying about one's birthplace apparently constitutes a heavy act of misrepresentation in marriages.
That's terrible.
I've heard about such discrimination towards those in small villages and civic classes. But in civics class, just because others knew you were from a tiny hamlet, you would be subjected to every societal disadvantage there was in a modern form of bullying. Though, I only memorized that because it was going to be on the latest test at the time. I recalled being suspicious about it and unable to believe such discrimination occurred in modern Japan.
Well, I suppose I can't say that they weren't asking for it. Our ancestors were proud of the demon blood flowing through them. They lived their lives boasting about it and scorned those at the foot of the mountain, after all. They struck fear into the villagers down there and with their mystique and demanded gifts of dread and tribute.
With that, Mion smiled for the first time, albeit in self-mockery.
During the Pacific War, despite the slogans that all the country was acting as one, those from Hamanazawa continued to suffer all manner of discrimination. There were too many ways to count. They would send their husbands and sons to war, and the women on the home front would suffer greatly, too. My grandmother remembers it well. She remembers not it being a difficult time. Even that bitterly long war, however, ended finally in 1945. Hamanazawa had lost many male hands, but at least their fathers and husbands and sons returned to them. Of course, there was also many who didn't come back. Nevertheless, for those in Hamanazawa, who were at their limits, barely able to maintain a village without the men, their return was a very happy thing. MacArthur's GHQ set to work on drastically improving mindsets and strove for the abolition of unfair discrimination. They could feel day breaking on the dismal night that was the previous era. Hamanazawa was on the verge of turning into a ghost town. Those in the village started to say that they should rebuild once again and go to work, trying to make the village even a little more plentiful. During that time, someone appeared who built up a fortune throughout a vast number of dealings in the black market. That was Mion's grandfather. That was Mion's grandfather. The husband of the elderly current family leader Shio Sonozaki. Shio said that he'd manage food warehouses in Harbin after being dispatched to the Chinese mainland. When it was time to pull out, he conspired with his superiors and comrades and stole a great deal of the army's canned goods. He had hid them somewhere in the Seto Inland Sea and sold them widely for at a high price on the black market, thus earning a fortune. Shio didn't spend that fortune for his own pleasure either. He entrusted the entire amount to his wife, the head of the Sonozaki house. Let's revive this ruined village. All who live here are our family, and this fortune is our collective property. So he proclaimed to my grandmother, the current head of the family. That vast fortune was a huge reason why Hamanazawa was revitalized after the war. I see. With that, Hamanazawa came back to life, and that's how the Sonozaki family had established its current prosperity. Of course, there were many people who begrudged the money coming from the black market, but the villagers no longer minded it. They succeeded at one business venture after another. Those who had succeeded freely supported those who followed them. The giant family of Hamanazawa, tied together with strong bonds, kept on expanding its influence. The Sonozaki family, the center of everything, would be extolled for a long time as the minds behind Hamanazawa's revitalization. Okay, I want to take a moment here that this music is grating and kind of terrible, but whatever.
The person at the middle of all of it was your Nana, Mi-chan? That's amazing! What a great success!
Mion looked like she was honestly happy Rena had praised her. However, around 1955, the wind started blowing in the other direction again, because of the canned flesh incident. Canned flesh? That sounded so hideous that just hearing it made me nauseous.
Someone naming himself as my grandfather, Shio Sonozaki's superior, confessed that those canned goods had been human flesh.
Hamanazawa, a village in which demons lived and ate humans. They were just about to wipe away that cursed stigma. The light they had finally started to see in their peaceful lives grew hazy and disappeared. The shocking truth, as revealed by his former superior, the stolen provisions from the old Japanese army that had been a huge cornerstone for Hamanazawa's revival, had been canned human flesh. Why were they in cans like that? Wasn't Shioe just a manager of food warehouses? His supervisor revealed that Shio Sonozaki did not have the job of managing the food.
In reality, Shioe's job during the war had been to exterminate pestilent mice and transport the corpses of those with infected diseases.
It had been an unfair treatment, and all because of the lowliness of his origins. As a result, though, he had returned safely without having been sent to the front lines or being detained. Perhaps that was the only fortunate thing to happen to him. Finally, Shioe was enlisted as an assailant at the military medical institution. There, however, he found something even worse than the low, scorned, depressing customs of Onigafuchi Village in the research they were carrying out. Could that have been, well, you know, the bacteriological corpse in the old Japanese army or whatever?
Kiyachi-kun, you've heard of that? What could it be?
I was pretty sure it was Unit 731. That it was a nightmare unit that devoted itself to researching terrifying bacteriological weapons to break the deadlock in the war. They used many innocent people as fodder for horrible human experiments. They methodically observed how many days a new strain would take to kill the new victims, how many days it would be when injected, how many days it would be when swallowed. They dissected many people to find that out. Sometimes they wouldn't bother waiting until they were dead and dissected them all while they were still alive. They would strap them into the centrifuges while still alive and crush them in decompression chambers while still alive.
When a live human decompresses, all the holes in their body get pushed outwards, and their intestines get pushed out of their anus like a snake winding out of it. I have a feeling I saw something like that on a documentary one time. That makes me sick. And they still hate Hamanazawa, huh?
You said it.
Mion agreed with me, giving a faint, sad smile. It wasn't much in the way of communication, but for some reason I was happy to have it right now.
The unit Shohei was in... did way kinder research than that. They were researching concrete methods for reintroducing the difficulty of delivering food on the battlefield.
The military's designs at the start of the war completely fell apart, and the chronic food shortage broke out all over the battlefront. The food shortage led to malnutrition, and as their natural resistances lowered, the soldiers fell to one disease after another. Spirit and morale lowered as well. They wouldn't be able to maintain their forces at this rate. Apparently, that's what their research started. That's where their research started. At first, it was to find methods of delivering food to battlefields. It was very broad and included things from violent methods like stealing it from citizens to survival methods like how to cook unfamiliar insects and plant life. As they were working out the details, they kept straying off course and going out of control until finally they knocked down a door called Taboo.
What do you think the easiest source of protein on the battlefield is?
Rena and I knew the answer without being told, so we didn't answer.
That's right. They were researching ways to handle using humans as food. Fighting onward, sometimes eating the flesh of enemies and sometimes that of allies, became the ultimate service paid to their country. They were deathly serious about this doctrine. It really is a riot. My grandfather was despised as someone who ate human flesh, and yet they had gone above and beyond that. Apparently, he always thought about it too. Even if he was a vulgar man-eating demon, they were far more ugly demons than he. So no matter how much he was scorned, he wouldn't put up with it. At last, they had a handful of test prototypes. When the soldiers learned it was human flesh, however, the scientists couldn't make anyone eat it. So it was apparently sent to the front lines. The cans were labeled meat substitutes, and so they would accidentally eat it. That they wouldn't accidentally eat it themselves, they stamped the bottoms with a circle. The starved soldiers on the front lines apparently loved all the prototypes they were sent. Among them, those who cooked it in soy sauce, like it was sukiyaki, loved it the most.
Come on, Mi-chan, stop! I'm getting sick to my stomach!
Rena was pale-faced, and she looked like she was having difficulty continuing to sit on her knees. Mion looked like she had more to say, but she sighed lightly and stopped there.
Then, those canned goods your grandpa brought back!
I don't know if it's true. Shio denied it was human flesh up until the day he died. However, those who begrudged Hamanazawa's sudden revival called him a savage for making a fortune from selling human flesh, and the villagers began to be scorned again. They returned to a time where their children would be jeered at to have rocks thrown at them.
The stifling silence came back. What a seriously hopeless and sad story it was. They discriminated, were discriminated against, and discriminated and were discriminated against. Why must they attach worth and rank to it? Why can't they live without looking down on people? Why can't everyone enjoy life together? I didn't know.
My grandmother, the family head, once told the children of the village this. If they throw a stone at one of you, then two of you must throw stones back. The children asked her, "What if they threw stones at two of us?" Of course, the answer was simple. If they throw stones at two of you, throw them back with four. If they chase eight of you with sticks, drive them off with 16. If they slander 30 of you, yell back with 60. Finally, the children asked, "What if we're attacked by 1,000 people?"
Even that answer was simple. If 1,000 people attack you, then everyone in Hamanazawa will stand up against them. It was a manifesto to spur people into action. My grandmother rose up not only as the leader of the Sonozaki house, but as the mother of Hamanazawa. It was halfway through 1955. It was a time when riots over the treaty in the U.S. were rampant, at a time of battle and action. The people of Hamanazawa joined together and fought, treating unfair discrimination towards one as a crime against them all. It didn't matter whether that one was a child or an adult. If they heard that a child had been told off, then everyone would crowd the house of the perpetrator acting as a whole. If they heard an adult had been treated unfairly, men and women, young and old, would all band together and stand up against it. If you meddled with people from Hamanazawa, you would be in trouble. They probably figured that if they could make others think that, they'd win. Kichen, do you remember how many people came to help you when you got involved with those delinquents in town?
I recalled how much of an impression it had left on me, that the people of Hamanazawa boldly came to my rescue, yet the people of Okunomiya averted their eyes so they wouldn't get involved.
My grandmother fought, and my parents carried on the fight. At last, peace returned to Hamanazawa. Of course, that peace had been placed on a razor's edge. When you consider the previous 100 years of history, the tranquility now can only be called a chance interval, standing on uneven scales.
Why? I couldn't really have an opinion on such a long and difficult history when I hadn't moved here more than a year ago. Yet, I said it anyway. Why can't everyone just live in peace? What happened to those old stories of Oshira-sama that I heard from Takano-san? Man and demon joined hands and lived together in harmony. Didn't Oshira-sama remain in this world to watch over that?
It's a fairy tale. I mean, that even those people and the demons were real, the Oshira-sama who meditated between them wasn't.
Is that why Oshira-sama something? Why Oshira-sama's curse happens? A cool gust of wind blows in from outside, fluttering Mion's long, beautifully clear hair. Mion kept her refreshing smile without answering, and didn't even change her expression, but even that became a silent answer.
So that Hamanazawa village might once more be like Onigafuchi village. So that we may again be a sacred existence worthy of worship. That was the earnest wish of our ancestors in Onigafuchi, and the mission of those who inherit the demon in the Sonozaki main family.
Those who inherit the demon?
For generations, the Sonozaki family has held a custom of including the character for demon in the leader's names. If you write out my name on your hand, it should appear plain as day.
I traced the word Mion on the palm of my hand. She's right. The character for demon is in there.
Not only in my name, either. The demon is engraved on my body as well.
When she said that, she quietly rose and began to lay her hand on her clothing.
It's okay, Mi-chan. You don't need to show us, okay?
Thank you.
With just that exchange, I guessed what she meant. Most likely, somewhere on her body, there was a permanent seal, such as a tattoo or marking, that proved that she inherited the demon. Mion didn't sit back down. She smoothly opened the paper door to the porch. A refreshing breeze began to cleanse the damp air filling the room. Mion quietly gazed out the wide yard for quite a while. On her shoulders was something I could never imagine the normal Mion carrying. It was heavy, heavy, truly heavy. History of Hamanazawa, no. Of Onigafuchi weighing down on them. What kind of words could I possibly say to a Mion like that? Rena wasn't saying anything to her either. Only the voices of the cicadas drowned out the silence. At last, after a long period of nothing, Mion murmured.
The serial incidents happening over the past 5 years. I was directly related to some of them and indirectly to others. Some were not the Sonozaki family, but were rather related to the others. The Kimiyashi family and the Furude family, I think, was at the center of all of them.
She said it all without turning around, with her back to us. At some point, her tone of voice had gone back to being the Mion we knew.
I have faith in what we've done, and I don't feel any guilt. If I did, perhaps it would be that I would have to leave the stage before the heir is decided. If I'm caught and tried in a court of law, then I suppose that's how it works nowadays. Being able to retire with Hamanazawa at its most peaceful it's been in 100 years could be the happiest thing that's ever happened to any of the Tsunizaki leaders of past generations.
Mion leaned on a shoulder against the paper door and slid down it and flopped on the ground. It was an act of such resignation that just seeing it made me hurt inside. The numerous terrible crimes Mion had been a part of suddenly began to fade from my mind. Hey, Mion, I don't care what happens after this. Can't you just try and struggle as much as you can? Try to run away? As soon as I began to think that way, Rena's ringing voice filled the room.
But Rika-chan and Satsuko-chan, you killed them, didn't you, Mi-chan?
The sharp points of her words stabbed into my chest despite not being directed at me.
I'm not saying that it's okay if you killed the other people. Regardless, Mi-chan, you killed Rika-chan and Satsuko-chan.
Rena's words were more biting than any I had ever heard. Even now that we knew all this heavy history pressing down on Mion's shoulders, she had criticized her for killing our friends.
Just as I bear the duty of the Tsunizaki family, Rika-chan bore the duty of the Furude family. That duty was to protect the ritual storehouse.
My chest tightened. I learned around last year that Rika-chan had said something about it. Oh, wait.
I learned around last year that Rika-chan had said something about it. The bars on the storehouse door were too heavy for her, and she wanted to change them to a simpler lock and key. Even the priest before her had complained about it being heavy. He was very aware of how hard it was for Rika-chan.
I will make sure to guard it, so I want to replace it with a lock with something lighter, I replied on behalf of the Tsunizaki family leader. Ever since the string of freak death incidents, there seem to be people who are insolent towards Oshira-sama, so you shouldn't replace the lock with a simpler one. That said, the leader of the Kimiyashi family, Old Man Kimiyashi, he... If it's that difficult for you, Rika-chan, then I think it's okay to replace the lock, he said. The very fact that it was locked with a key was an indication of it being somewhere you mustn't enter. There's nobody bad enough to break through it and go inside, he said. Even if we were alike as leaders, I couldn't find it in me to argue with Old Man Kimiyashi. I think this is Shion talking.
Since I owed him so much. In the end, we decided to change out the lock on the storehouse and switch it to a really cheap and light padlock. Old man. Is this really all right? Nana says that as if... That... If possible, we should keep the lock the same.
It'll be all right. You're quite the worrywart. If something happens, this old man will take all the responsibility.
Do you promise? You mean that you will take the responsibility as leader of the Kimiyashi family, right? You should be well aware of how sacred the things inside really are.
It's okay. There aren't any bad cats in Hamanazawa who would break open the lock and break in.
Meow, meow.
Wait. Is this Rika talking?
It's okay. There aren't any bad cats in Hamanazawa who would open the lock and break in. Meow, meow.
Ugh. Oh. The sobs escaped from my mouth. Something hot and wet dripped down in spades and fell onto the tatami mat.
I had already heard of the thieves entering the ritual storehouse during the Watanagashi festival. There were 4 of them. We decided to act within the day. At the same time, we needed to demand that the ones who allowed the thieves to break in, Rika-chan and the Furude family, and Old Man Kimiyashi, take the responsibility.
My tears dripped and dropped, dripped and dropped. Until just now, I had decided that it was Mion's fault that she killed Rika-chan and the others. That was wrong. The one who killed them wasn't Mion. It was me. I might as well have killed them.
Kiachi-kun!
I had a chance to stop this tragedy from happening, and yet I didn't. Cheap curiosity got the better of me, and I didn't. If at that time I had stopped us from sneaking into the ritual storehouse, Rika-chan and the others wouldn't have had to die. If I had, then nothing would have happened. We would be spending our days having lots of fun, like we always did. I was an idiot. If by shedding tears I could take it all back, I would have filled up the room with them. However, such a meager act wouldn't be enough to redeem myself for the crime I have committed.
Ki-chan, you're not at fault.
Mion gently began to speak to me as if trying to reason with me.
As leader of the Sonozaki family, I needed to act. But given the history of the Sonozaki family, thinking about it now, it's no big deal. Maybe I should have saved my friends, even if it meant casting all that aside. I yielded to it, and that's why I killed those two. I mean, I, Mion Sonozaki, and nobody else killed them. I had hundreds of chances to stop it, but I didn't stop. I gave in to the easy role that was handed to me, and abandoned all the thoughts of fighting for my friends. So this is my crime. I killed them. Mion Sonozaki, with these hands, killed them. And nothing whatsoever changed. Nothing.
Her masochistic laughter was sad. Especially because Mion boasted in the club that she would turn the tables on whatever predicaments presented themselves. It was so painful.
Still, Mi-chan, you saved one person of your own volition.
Eh?
As I looked at her surprise, Rena stuck her finger right at my forehead.
You left Kiachi-kun alive. As strong as you are, Mi-chan, it would have been no trouble for you to, but you didn't kill him.
That's right. Mion was so cunning that nobody could stand up to her, even in our club. If she had seriously tried to kill me, I would have been dealt with the very first night. So many people had been sacrificed, but I was still always left out in the cold. When did I first realize it? Even though people were disappearing one after the other, for some reason I had this vague belief that only I would be left alive.
Why didn't I kill him? As a demon, I can't even begin to guess. Maybe Mion had some reason she didn't want to kill you.
What's that supposed to mean? Mion put a finger to her lips to say that Rena didn't need to talk. Wait.
What's that supposed to mean?
Is Awashi-san waiting outside?
Yes.
Any way out?
No. They said they have the place surrounded. It seemed like they called a lot of cars over the radio. I think they have your entire property surrounded.
Mion fell silent. Rena's merciless words felt cruel. But they weren't meant to be. Maybe they were trying to lessen her good friend's pain, if only a little. Maybe they were considerate, like she was trying to help.
Please, turn yourself in.
Mion didn't open her mouth, but she smiled just a little.
We'll go with you. We'll never leave a friend by herself.
Crying children and Rena are the only things I can't beat.
She rose, scratching her head. Her face had returned entirely to that of the usual Mion.
I am well aware of how serious my own crimes are. Even if they accept me turning myself in, I'll probably never be able to come back here.
I couldn't say anything. The numbers of deaths Mion was involved in was just too large. So much so that maybe recommending that she turn herself in was, in a way, extremely cruel.
So I'd like you to hear one last selfish request.
What is it?
30 minutes is fine. Just let me have some time alone with Kii-chan.
Huh? My name suddenly came up and it looked like I was the only one surprised about it.
Kiachi-kun, is that okay with you? If you don't want to, then I won't make you.
You're right.
You're right. It's okay if you don't want to. After all, I am a demon. And Kii-chan is a bona fide human who moved here from somewhere else. For us to be compatible, as long as Oshira-sama doesn't exist to mediate, simply is impossible.
There was no reason for me to hesitate. Mion had been engulfed by heavy, unstoppable tradition. Right now, the duty of handling this had fallen to me and me alone. In fact, with me cornered, it would have been okay for her to blame me. However, Mion didn't say one word of blame. Far from it, I was guilty of the same crime and she let me go. Amidst the fate she could not oppose, she saved me alone. I didn't know whether I should be thankful for that. Thinking upon it now, I didn't know how much easier it would be if I were to be granted the same punishment as Rika-chan and the others. The only thing I knew for sure was that I had an equal duty to bear the sins that Mion shouldered. So when it came to Mion's last request, there was no reason for me to hesitate. Sure, it's fine.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank you too, Kiachi-kun.
Rena stood up. It looked like she would keep her promise with Mion and leave.
It's fine, Rena. You can wait right here. I just want to go around the yard with Kii-chan. If you're bored, you can go up to my room. You can read any manga you like. And if there are any volumes you like, you might as well take them.
I won't do that. I don't want to. Mii-chan's books belong to Mii-chan. Rena couldn't bring them back home with her so freely.
You're such a good kid. Only at times like this.
Mion took Rena's head and rubbed it violently like I always did.
Okay, let's go, Kii-chan.
I began to walk after Mion, who had headed for the hallway when Rena silently stopped me.
Take care of Mii-chan.
Yeah.
Mii-chan really does believe that she won't ever be able to come back.
I didn't know much about laws, but with as many deaths as she'd been involved in, the chances of her escaping a heavy punishment seemed non-existent.
Watch out so you don't make her lose her temper, okay?
Mion might not surrender herself to justice, so I might have to put an end to it myself. Rena had already thought that far ahead. Right. I won't let that happen. Rena rubbed at her tears, which had fallen without me noticing them.
Okay then, go after her.
I nodded and followed Mion, who had disappeared out the front door. I could clearly hear Rena sobbing from the other side of the paper door. Why was Mii-chan made the successor to demons? Maybe it's just had to happen that way, but it's just so awful. Something hot burned down my cheeks. They were my tears. I fiercely wiped them away. This was the last of my time I could offer to Mion, so I absolutely didn't want to let her see my tears during it. Mion was already waiting outside the front door.